In this lesson, we will work through an example of a three-reservoir problem. Here we have three water reservoirs connected by three pipes, all of which are connected at a node N. The water temperature is 60 degrees Fahrenheit, and the pipe diameters, absolute roughnesses, and lengths are all known. Pipe 1 has a diameter D of 1 foot and a length L of 1,000 feet. Pipe 2 has a diameter of 0.75 feet and a length of 500 feet. Pipe 3 has a diameter of 0.5 feet and a length of 400 feet. All three pipes have an absolute roughness epsilon of 0.001 feet. We assume the reservoirs are so large that the water level doesn't change significantly in time, and the elevation at the top of each reservoir is known. The elevation of reservoir A, ZA, is 100 feet higher than the elevation of reservoir C, ZC, and the elevation of reservoir B, ZB, is 20 feet higher than the elevation of reservoir C. We want to find the flow speed and flow direction in each pipe. Before we begin solving this problem, it should be noted that this is not necessarily a great way to configure a set of reservoirs, but understanding how to solve a problem like this helps us prepare to tackle more complicated pipe network problems. As fluid flows between the reservoirs, the total head H of the fluid changes. The total head represents the total mechanical energy in the flow and is equal to the pressure head, P over gamma, plus the velocity head, V squared over 2G, plus the elevation head, Z. Fluids flow from a region of higher total head to lower total head, but sometimes the flow direction is not immediately obvious. In the system shown here, it may be obvious that water will flow out of reservoir A through pipe 1, and water will flow into reservoir C through pipe 3, since reservoir A has the highest elevation and reservoir C has the lowest elevation. But it isn't clear whether the water will flow into or out of reservoir B. Even if you believe water will flow into reservoir B at its current elevation, you could imagine raising the elevation of reservoir B until water would begin to flow out of the reservoir. Fortunately, the method that we'll use to solve this three-reservoir problem does not require us to know the flow direction in advance. Here is the general procedure of how to solve a three-reservoir problem. First, guess the direction of flow in each pipe. It's okay to be wrong, since the conservation equations will automatically correct themselves for any incorrect guesses on flow direction. Next, we apply the conservation of mass equation at node N. Then we will apply the conservation of energy equation for each reservoir, with the inlet at the free surface and the outlet at node N. At this point in the problem, we will have four equations and four unknowns. And the final step involves solving the equations in order to find the flow rates and flow directions in each pipe. We start by guessing a flow direction in each pipe. Our guesses for the flow direction can be wrong. As long as we apply the conservation laws correctly based on our choice of flow direction, it all will work out in the end. Let's guess an unphysical situation where all the flows go into node N. We draw a control volume around the node and apply the conservation of mass equation. Since water will behave as an incompressible fluid in typical flow conditions, which means the density of water is constant throughout the system, the sum of the volumetric flow rates into the node is equal to the sum of the volumetric flow rates out of the node. Since the flow direction from all three pipes is into the node, we have Q1 plus Q2 plus Q3 equals 0. We replace the volumetric flow rates with speed times the cross-sectional area for each pipe, which is pi over 4 times d squared. We can divide both sides of the equation by pi over 4, and the equation becomes V1 times D1 squared plus V2 times D2 squared plus V3 times D3 squared equals 0. We have one equation and three unknowns, V1, V2, and V3. We now apply the conservation of energy equation from the free surface of each reservoir to node N. Since we assume the flow in all pipes is into the node will be the outlet and the free surface of the reservoir will be the inlet. We draw a control volume that includes reservoir A and pipe 1. The conservation of energy equation is the sum of the pressure head plus velocity head plus elevation head at node N equals the pressure head plus velocity head plus elevation head at the free surface A minus the head loss from A to N plus the pump head minus the turbine head. The three terms on the left can be combined into a single term, HN, which is the total head at node N. The gauge pressure and flow speed at free surface A are zero, making the pressure head and velocity head at A equal to zero. The pump head and turbine head are zero because no pumps or turbines exist in the control volume. To simplify this problem, we will assume the system geometry is such that the minor losses are much smaller than the major losses. If we wanted to include the minor losses, we would need additional information about the system, such as the type of connection between the reservoir and pipe. We bring the total head at node N to the right side of the equation and replace the major losses term by the Darcy-Weisbach equation. For pipe 1, the Darcy-Weisbach equation is the friction factor F1 times the pipe length L1 divided by pipe diameter D1 times flow speed V1 times the absolute value of V1 divided by 2 times the gravitational acceleration G. In previous videos, we've written the Darcy-Weisbach equation as V squared instead of using V times the absolute value of V. This modification is necessary because we may have guessed the wrong direction for V1. Let's say our guess is incorrect and that water actually flows from node N into reservoir A. In that case, the head loss term should change signs since the inlet and outlet have flipped. But if we use V1 squared in the head loss term, there's no way for the head loss term to change signs. By using V1 times absolute value of V1, if we accidentally guess the wrong flow direction, we'll calculate a negative value for the speed, which will allow the head loss term to change signs. At this point, we have found our second equation, but now have five unknowns: the three speeds, the total head at node N, and the friction factor F1. The second application of the conservation of energy equation involves reservoir B. We draw a control volume that includes reservoir B and pipe 2 and apply the conservation of energy equation, assuming the inlet is at free surface B and the outlet is at node N. The sum of the pressure head plus velocity head plus elevation head at node N, which we call HN, equals the pressure head plus velocity head plus elevation head at free surface B minus the head loss from B to N plus the pump head minus the turbine head. The gauge pressure and flow speed at free surface B are zero, making the pressure head and velocity head at B equal to zero. The pump head and turbine head are zero because no pumps or turbines exist in the control volume. Moving HN to the right side of the equation and using the Darcy-Weisbach equation for the head loss, we have an equation that looks similar to the equation derived for reservoir A and pipe 1. 0 equals the elevation, ZB, minus HN minus the head loss through pipe 2, which is friction factor F2 times L2 over D2 times V2 times the absolute value of V2 divided by 2G. We now have three equations and six unknowns, having added F2 to our list of unknowns. The third and final application of the conservation of energy equation involves reservoir C and pipe 3. We draw a control volume that includes reservoir C and pipe 3, with the inlet at free surface C and outlet at node N. The conservation of energy equation gives that the total head HN equals the pressure head plus velocity head plus elevation head at free surface C minus the head loss from C to N plus the pump head minus the turbine head. The gauge pressure and flow speed at free surface C are zero, making the pressure head and velocity head there equal to zero. The pump head and turbine head are zero because no pumps or turbines exist in the control volume. Moving HN to the right side of the equation and using the Darcy-Weisbach equation for the head loss, we have 0 equals the elevation ZC minus the total head at node N minus the head loss through pipe 3, which is the friction factor F3 times L3 over D3 times V3 times the absolute value of V3 divided by 2G. We found a fourth equation and added the unknown F3. Assuming the flow is turbulent, we can use the Halland equation for the three friction factors. After we solve this problem for V1, V2, and V3, we can check whether the turbulent assumption was valid. Friction factor F1 is a function of pipe 1's absolute roughness and diameter, as well as the Reynolds number in pipe 1. And the Reynolds number contains fluid density rho, the fluid's absolute viscosity mu, pipe diameter D1, and flow speed V1. The absolute roughness and diameter were given. And since the water temperature is known, that allows us to find the density and absolute viscosity of the fluid. This means the only unknown quantity in the expression for F1 is the speed V1. Notice that the Reynolds number uses the absolute value of V1. This is required because the Reynolds number must always be a positive quantity, and V1 will be negative if we guess the wrong direction of flow through pipe 1. We can write similar expressions for F2 and F3. V2 is the only unknown in the expression for F2, and V3 is the only unknown in the expression for F3. Now let's review our situation. We have three equations from conservation of energy, and one equation from conservation of mass. The Halland equation will be used to calculate the friction factors and our functions of the unknown speeds. This means the conservation equations are functions of the unknowns V1, V2, V3, and Hn. So, in principle, we can solve for the four unknowns. One possible way to solve these equations is through iteration, where you start off by guessing a value of Hn. The value of Hn is plugged into the conservation of energy equations to calculate the values of V1, V2, and V3. The three calculated speeds are plugged into the conservation of mass equation to check if they satisfy that equation. That is, we want to check if the right side of the conservation of mass equation is approximately zero. If our initial guess for Hn is incorrect, which it likely will be, in that case, we can keep refining our guess of Hn until the conservation of mass equation is satisfied. The four conservation equations together comprise a set of nonlinear algebraic equations. Various software packages, such as MATLAB, have built-in functions that can solve a set of nonlinear algebraic equations very quickly. The equations must be written in the form of 0 equals some function of the unknowns, which we have done already. Here's an example of one way to solve this problem with MATLAB's built-in function called fsolve. We start by opening up a MATLAB file, which is usually called an M file, to define the equations we want MATLAB to solve. I will call this M file conservationequations.m, and the file will store a function named conservation equations. We start the function with function f in brackets equals conservation equations v in parentheses. F refers to the values of the conservation equations at the current values of the unknowns, and v is an array containing the values of the four unknowns, the three speeds v1, v2, v3, and the total head at node n. We assign values for the fluid density and absolute viscosity. At 60 degrees Fahrenheit, the water density is 1.94 slugs per cubic foot, and the absolute viscosity is 2.34 times 10 to the minus 5 pounds force seconds per foot squared. And we define the gravitational acceleration g, setting it equal to 32.2 foot per second squared. Next, the pipe lengths, diameters, and absolute roughnesses are defined. Notice that all lengths are in feet. The elevations for the free surfaces of the reservoirs are stored in variables ZA, ZB, and ZC. Then the Reynolds numbers in each pipe, RE1, RE2, and RE3, are calculated using the unknown speeds V1, V2, and V3. The absolute value of the speeds are calculated using MATLAB's built-in function ABS. And notice that we need to write the unknown speeds as vector components using parentheses. The friction factors for each pipe, F1, F2, and F3, can then be calculated. Next, we assign the value of the fourth unknown to the variable Hn. Finally, we calculate the values of the three energy equations at the current values of the four unknowns and store the results in the first, second, and third elements of the F vector. We also calculate the value of the conservation of mass equation at the current values of the unknowns and store the result in the fourth element of the F vector. The conservation equations function is terminated with the end command. We now go to the command line in MATLAB where we can execute code. We need to come up with some initial guesses for the four unknowns, and we will store these guesses in a vector called vguesses. Let's arbitrarily use the number 10 for the initial guesses of our four unknowns. That is, our guess for v1, v2, and v3 is 10 feet per second, and our guess for the total head at node n is 10 feet. These are almost certainly incorrect. MATLAB's built-in fsolve function is used by writing fsolve, and then in parentheses, at conservation equations, comma, vguesses. The first argument for fsolve is the function name, and the second argument is our set of initial guesses for the unknowns. Fsolve will quickly find the value of the unknowns and store them in the vector v. After entering this command, we find the first element of v, which is the speed v1, is positive 11.24 feet per second. The second element of v, which is the speed v2, is negative 13.59 feet per second. The third element of v, which is the speed v3, is negative 14.37 feet per second, and the total head at node n is positive 60.87 feet. Whenever we find a positive value for speed, it indicates that we guessed a flow direction correctly. And whenever we find a negative value for a speed, it indicates that we guessed a flow direction incorrectly. So water actually flows into reservoirs B and C. At this point, you should verify that the Reynolds number in each pipe is greater than 4,000, which would mean that our turbulent flow assumption was okay. We'll leave that as a fun exercise for the viewer.